You're listening to the BBM Global Network with 25 years in broadcast audio and video production. Our passionate team creates content and marketing for the world of Internet talk radio. If you've got a passion, come join us at bbmglobalnetwork.com. The BBM Global Network. Your voice is now heard.
Welcome the host of Dr. T, PhD, Dr. Hilaire Taverner.
And I can feel the Holy Spirit now, because I believe.
Welcome, everyone. I'm your host, Dr. Hilaire Taverner, and you're listening to Dr. T, PhD, on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. As always, I like to thank Paul Kolesky for his beautiful song called I Believe. If you'd like to hear the whole version, you'd need to go to paulkolesky.com and obtain one of his DVDs. His music is phenomenal. This is one talented and humble man, and I love the song I Believe because God knows I do. At this time, as you know, I always like to begin with a prayer. So I thought maybe tonight I would especially like to pray for writers. Okay, so if you would join me, please, in this collective prayer. God bless all of you who have taken time to tune in. And, you know, we're going to just collect our thoughts and become present to God. God is present to us 24/7, but we don't always return the favor because we're busy doing other things. But now let us just pause and place ourselves before God. Almighty God, you told us where two or three are gathered in your holy name, that you would be in their midst. You are always in our midst, and we are so grateful for your constant, unconditional love that you have for every soul you have made. And we want to give you thanks for so many blessings, but we also want to, especially in this moment, give thanks for the writers. Those men and women who spend years, hours, countless amount of time writing a book, writing a journal, writing a memoir, teaching us about science, about math, about history. God bless all of those wonderful souls who find the strength to take their inspiration and put it on paper. We pray for all writers, especially those writers that are going to be joining us in Lorain, Ohio, this coming weekend on April the 5th and 6th. It is the 7th annual Northeast Ohio Christian Writers Conference. And there will be between 70 and 80 writers gathering. Many times this happens around our nation, and I imagine around the world. And we collaborate and teach each other. We share our stories. We share our lives. But truly, we want to learn from each other, and that's why we come together. If you're at all interested, just take a look at our website. It's called internationalwritersassociation.com. You can sign up there. You can even pay on PayPal. You can learn about the speakers and the programs. And so, Almighty God, this coming weekend, not this weekend, but next weekend, we ask that you will be there in our midst. Inspire us, comfort us, enlighten us, and teach us. Almighty God, the prayer of all the true writers of the world, ask you that we might be a pen in your hand to write the truth, to write the inspiration, to write the stories that people need to hear. We give you thanks, Almighty God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Spirit God Creator. Amen. So, next week, we're going to have a couple of guests from Detroit, Michigan, and this is going to be, their names are Rudy and Cindy Oakes, and they're married, and they're both doctors, medical doctors. I'm a PhD. I'm a doctor of philosophy. I'm not a medical doctor. But they're going to talk about a miracle that Rudy seems to have had. He had fourth stage, I believe, pancreatic cancer. And his wife, Cindy, had this devotion to Blessed Solanus Casey, a very, very humble priest from Detroit. And so when she found out her beloved husband, Rudy, had this death sentence, if you don't mind, she began to say, let us pray. Let us talk to Blessed Solanus Casey and ask for his intercession. If he's in heaven, he can get to God even all the faster and plead our cause. And so that's what they're going to do next week. They're going to tell us about this journey because as of right now, Rudy seems to be totally cured. It's unbelievable. It truly is a miracle. And we're going to be talking to Cindy and ask about this journey and about Father Solanus Casey. So I certainly hope you join in next week. Now, today, I'm hoping that my friend Robert Moore is here. Let me check. I'm not sure. Robert, are you there? Okay, there's some silence. So I wonder what that means. Robert was going to and is going to talk to us about technology. But wouldn't you know it that sometimes technology doesn't work as well as it should be. I hope everything's all right with him. I'm a little concerned because he's so dependable. I know this man very well. He's studied technology. He has taught it for over 20 years. And he is going to teach us about some of the caveats. I think we're experiencing one right now. My concern is, you know, he's got this beautiful little baby. She's only 1 year old. And sometimes you wonder about little kids, you know, if they get sick or if there's something wrong in the family or something takes place. So Robert is hopefully going to be joining us soon. What I think maybe we could do, if it's all right with my tech man, maybe we could take an early break and I can kind of look into that situation. So I don't know. Is this possible? All right. God bless you. Hold on. Don't go away. We'll still try to get our program in. Thank you.
Global Glory. That's the work of Dr. Marina McLean, COO of Global Glory, whose calling is to serve God. A first-generation British-born Londoner of Jamaican descent, Dr. McLean inherited the hunger for the word from her father, who was a Bible teacher. Growing up, her home was filled with missionaries from the Caribbean islands and America, and she travels the world preaching the gospel. She has a Bachelor of Arts degree in theology and an honorary doctorate of divinity and Christian counseling from Friends International Christian University. Dr. McLean is also a songwriter and recording artist, and her songs are written during summits and conferences in the presence of God. She's recorded 3 worship albums to date and is in ministry for 28 years alongside her husband, Dr. Rennie McLean, who shares her passion. Visit www.globalglory.org or on Facebook at Global Glory. Call 866-244-5679 and feel the glory.
Attorney Renee Marie Smith is changing the way we sell real estate. She wrote a series of books called My Short Sale Guru Guides for all real estate practitioners. Whether you're a homeowner wanting to understand the process, process, an agent who has been handling short sales for years, or an industry analyst wanting to know how short sales impact your business, Renee uses her vast real estate experience to take a comprehensive look at the recent market phenomena while relaying it in an easy-to-understand format. Through her company, Smith Title Services, Renee has counseled thousands of short sale participants and processed in excess of 1,000 short sales. Her knowledge is transformational for real estate professionals and laymen alike, and her live presentations provide people the opportunity to ask specific questions about their issues. Buy her books and schedule her to speak at your next event. Visit www.smithtitleservices.com or call 305-705-3428 or email her at renee@smithtitleservices.com. Isn't it time to sell your property today? Learn the My Short Sale Guru way.
Welcome back, everyone. So glad you haven't abandoned me. I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD, and we're coming to you live on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. I'm so glad that you've decided to stay with us. And I know many of you know our programs and that today it's supposed to be Robert Moore, a good friend of mine. He was the vice president of the International Writers Association for about 10 years. So I've worked with him very closely through the years. He married a few years ago and he's got a little baby girl. He just recently, in fact, yesterday, sent me a photograph, a little Jade, this beautiful little girl. And so he just wanted me to have a picture. And where did it go? It went where all great pictures go, under the refrigerator door, you know, and that's where it is, because it reminds me to pray for this precious little girl and this beautiful family. So we're in a situation, and I've been doing this for 5 months, my friends, 5 months. And this is the first time this has happened. And I can't explain why my guest has not called in. But my tech will let me know if he calls in late. But, you know, we're just going to wing it if you don't mind listening to me for a while. I don't know as if I'm a fountain of great knowledge and all that good stuff, but I would like to say a few things. I've got this opportunity, you know, 20 years ago, this is an anniversary year, 20 years ago, there was four of us in the city of Lorain, Ohio, that got together and started a group called the Friends of Helen Steiner Rice. And one was her brother-in-law, and one was an elderly couple who had died a number of years ago. And they knew Helen. And so they wanted her to be honored in her hometown. There's a saying, and I think it's in scripture somewhere, that sometimes a prophet is not known in their own town or not recognized. They might be famous outside of their hometown, but in their own hometown, they're still just, you know, Bobby down the street or, you know, Mary over there lives near the park. So it's kind of interesting. Helen Steiner Rice is a world famous poet. And I say she's world famous because when I was in Ireland, you know, some people, I didn't do this, but some people brought her name up and they were talking about how much they love her inspirational verses. And I thought, well, that's interesting. I told them right away, by the way, that Helen Steiner Rice is from my hometown in Lorain, Ohio. And of course, they were surprised. I guess they didn't realize where she was from. They only know that they love her poetry. She's had over 75 books of poetry published. She is, I know when I lived in New York, you know, a lot of churches, a lot of schools, a lot of students have gone to her poetry to find inspiration. I've always called her a pen in the hand of God. And so, you know, in 1993, I was down in Florida finishing up my doctorate. And my mother was not well. She had emphysema. And it wasn't good, and I was worried. But I called her doctor, and I asked the doctor, I said, you know, what's going on with Mom? I understand you want her to go into a nursing home. And he says to me, he says, look, I really think maybe this is very serious. You know, she's been sick for a while. You know, she smoked all those years. I think she needs somebody with her. She needs to be in a nursing home. And I said, doctor, that's not going to happen. My mother had seven wonderful kids and she poured her life into us. I said, I'm going to call my mother and I'm going to ask her if I can come home. And, then I asked him a very personal question. I said, I know you're not God and you don't know all the answers. I understand that. but how long do you think my mother has to live? And he was very frank with me. He was an excellent doctor. And he said, I think maybe 6 months. And I thought, well, I'm not staying in Florida for the last 6 months of my mother's life. So I called her up and I said, Mom, can I come home? And she said, yes, dear, of course, you can always come home. I said, okay, fine, I'm on my way. So I thought I could get home as soon as possible. That was at Thanksgiving. But the hang up was I couldn't sell my home. I had a beautiful home and brand new and very comfortable. And I'd lived there for 6 years in that particular house. I'd lived other places too. I spent 10 years in Florida working on my doctorate. And so then what I did do is after 6 months, I sold the house, and that's when I came home. And now I'm here for my mother, and guess what? She didn't live for 6 months. She lived for 6 years, and I think it's pretty easy to understand why. She was in her own home, in her own space. She lived in this house for 50 years. This is where she raised her family. She and my dad raised 7 really good people. 2 of those good people are home with God. But the other 5 of us are still here, plugging along and doing the best we can in life. I think that I have the greatest respect for my brothers and sisters, every one of them. They're all married with children, and they're all hardworking. They're all ethical. They're all godly souls. My mom and dad did a really, really good job. So anyway, after 6 years, mother did die. And before she died, she said to me, and my childhood name was Sally, by the way. My grown-up name is Mary Hilaire. That's a story. You know, everything's a story. I'm Irish. So, you know, the Irish were storytellers. And this is how the story goes. My mom and dad used to take turns naming the kids. I was kid number 4, and it was dad's turn. And so he wanted to name me Sally after a former girlfriend and Lynn after his great uncle. And my mother knew this Sally and thought the world of her, thought she was an awfully nice person, had no problem with it. So when I was born, the birth certificate says Sally Lynn. And then in time, my mother took me to be baptized because we are Catholic Christians. My dad was a Methodist. But anyway, mom saw that we would be baptized. And when she tried to get me baptized, the priest said, sorry, but there is no Saint Sally. So we really can't do that. You could do Sarah. And my mother said, no, well, we're pretty Irish. My mother's Mary Alice. I'm Mary Catherine. And go ahead and make her Mary, Mary Lynn, baptize her Mary. I don't know if you folks out there know what the word Mary means, but the translation is sorrowful. It means sorrow. So that's pretty interesting of all the, my father's name was Robert, which means noble. And my mother's name was Catherine, which means pure in spirit. So anyway, this is what happened. I went and got baptized as Mary Lynn. And when I was 17, by that time, I knew I wanted to be a nun. I actually wanted to be a nun since I was probably 13 or 14. And so I applied to Syracuse, New York, and I went off when I was right after graduation. I went off to the convent. I was 17 years old. I left Lorain, Ohio, and traveled, about 300 miles to the east to Syracuse, New York. And I'm going to tell you then next what happens after that. Stay with us. There's some fun stories to share. Thank you for putting up with me. Don't go away. God bless. Thank you.
Baby boomers face many challenges, and sometimes you have to reinvent yourself in order to stay on top. Sharon Ball, nurse practitioner and Christian life and wellness coach, can help. Sharon has written a book called Reinventing Yourself Today, and it can help you through the pangs of changing the course of your life. Whether you are looking to stay on track with new goals, a sensible program to help you shed unwanted pounds, or a full kick-butt life reinvention, Sharon can work with you. Follow your passions and live each day according to your dreams and free yourself from the expectations of others. Sharon comes from the heart and shares her own personal journey to reinvention with her clients. Other self-help books inspired her, but few gave her the steps to improve her life, so she created a plan that works. Stress no more. Let Sharon Ball open the door. sign up for a complimentary life reinvention consultation today at tinyurl.com/get-started-for-free for more of what life has in store.
Escape from Hell, A Woman's Story is a passionate book that tells the true story of author Rhonda Knutson's journey through the darkness and adversity of abuse. The book takes readers on an emotional trail from the depths of despair to the heights of forgiveness and understanding. She was inspired to help others, and her book is a vital tool through this process. Faithful to God and devotional to her beacon of hope, Rhonda Knutson is a perfect example of finding a guiding light that helped her come through the dark and into the light. Her book can assist you in overcoming your challenges with abuse. The publication of Escape from Hell, A Woman's Story, is a triumphant achievement, and it can help you take ownership of your own experience of abuse and come through stronger than before. Rhonda is currently working on two more books, Shadows of Corruption and Coast to Coast on a Piece of Toast. To read more about this inspiring author and purchase her books, visit RhondaKnutson.com or go to www.amazon.com.
Welcome back, everyone. As you know, I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner, and you're listening to Dr. T, PhD, and we're coming to you live on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. So glad that you're staying with us. I know you tuned in to listen to Mr. Robert Moore, and he was going to talk about technology in life. He had planned to explain some of the good things about technology, some of the things that are not so good about technology. And trust me, this man is an authority. And so this is very problematic for me. I've been doing this for 5 months now, and I haven't had a surprise like this. But I am going to ask you to please keep him in your prayers, because it is so unusual. I don't know what has happened. But I do know that you and I are here together, and I'm kind of talking about me. I guess I like to interview other people because I'm so interested in other people. But, you know, maybe there's a few things about me that you might find interesting. Like I told you, when I was a little girl, I'd say, I don't know, maybe 12 or 13, I knew I didn't want to be married. I knew I didn't want children, and I knew I wanted to be a nun. I just didn't tell anybody. I really didn't. I think the first one I told was my dad. And this is true, too. It is what it is. I'm not going to change the truth. My dad was an alcoholic. He had won a four-year scholarship to Wesleyan University here in Ohio. He was such a good basketball player, but he was an excellent athlete. So he got a four-year ride. Now, back in the day of 1939, he's in a Protestant Methodist college. And back in the day, you know, they did not do drinking and smoking and cussing. And especially on Sundays, they really had some hard, rules. And my brother, my dad, for whatever reason, started to drink on Friday nights with some of the other boys. And the other boys, I don't think it was a problem for them, but my father had the DNA, that one little whatever it is that says you can't stop drinking. Scientists tell us that if you've got 10 people, all 10 of them can drink, but one of them can't stop. The other 9, they can do it socially. They can do it on occasion. It doesn't impair their life choices. But my father was one of those that was addicted. And the word addicted, you probably know, dick means speak, like diction or dictionary. So an AD means speak to. So an addiction is something that tells you what to do. It takes away your freedom of choice, you know, whether it's an opiate addiction or a gambling addiction or a sex addiction or, you know, there's all kinds of addictions. And my father had this alcoholic addiction. And unfortunately, that was a hardship for all of us. But I told my dad, we were in a bar together. He was having a drink. And I said, Dad, you know, I've been thinking long and hard, but I think I want to become a nun. Oh, my glory, was he upset. Oh, that was not fun. He said, you are not becoming a nun. He says, I let you hang around with those nuns sometimes, but Sally, they're brainwashing you. You don't want to be a nun. You want to get married. You want to have kids, a family. You want to have control over your life. There's no way. If you go and be a nun, I'm going to go over to that convent and knock the walls down. You're not going to enter the convent. Not over my dead body. I mean, he was like, oh, so I tell you, he scared me. So I didn't talk about it anymore until it had to be talked about. And then I mentioned it to my mother. And she wasn't, she was like, okay, well, whatever you want. That's where she was. But I knew what I wanted. And the night before I entered, my mother said, you are not leaving this town. My brother Bob had been willing to drive me over to Syracuse. It was about a 6-hour drive back in those days. And he is going to drive me over and then come back. Because here I am 17, I don't have my own car, I don't have much money or anything. And so my brother Bob was willing to do it. So the night before I'm entering, my mother says, there is no way you're leaving without talking to your father. So I said, I know. So Dad came home and I said, Dad, can I talk to you about something? He said, yeah. So we went out in the side yard and he said, I said, Dad, you see the trunk in the sun porch. You know I've been filling it. You know what I want to do. You know what I'm going to do. And he said, you know what, Sally? You have one hell of a lot of nerve. He didn't say heck. He said hell, one hell of a lot of nerve. He says, but I really respect you, and I'm going to let you go under one condition. And, of course, I was ecstatic. Dad, what? And he says, you promised me that you come back in 1 year. I said, Dad, it doesn't work like that. I might have a connection. I might belong there. I don't know. I might be back in 2 weeks. I don't know. I just feel this calling, and I need to do it. And he said, well, all right, I'm going to let you do it. And so the next night it happened after a hug from my dad, and he loved me unconditionally. He loved all of his kids. So the next night, my brother drives me all the way to Syracuse, and we drove all night long. He drops me. He has breakfast with me, and then he comes back. I think he slept in his car on the way home. And so I'm always grateful to my brother. Yes, I entered when I was 17. And then the first thing they tell me is I'm going to have to pick a nun name, another name. Oh, I forgot to tell you, when I entered, I needed my baptismal certificate. And when I ordered it, I said, Mom, who's Mary Lynn? You always called me Sally. I'm confused. And that's when she explained the story about, you know, there is no Saint Sally. So there I was, Syracuse, New York, and I spent 20 years there. I wrote a book called None of This and None of That. Yeah, you can get it on my website, which is dutchinc.com, dutchinc.com. And it's about convent life in the 60s. And it's about how you make a nun out of a teenage girl. And, you know, think about it. When I was 17, the Vietnam War was going on. And I went to school with some of the nicest guys, I'm telling you. But if they joined the military, and some of them got drafted, you know, they had to become killing machines. They had to kill other people. What kind of training do you go through to change from a nice guy and a fun guy with a great sense of humor to somebody who's going to kill another person? So I, too, went through a transformation. It took 3 years of, you know, intensive, you might call it brainwashing, but they tried to get me to get closer to God and follow the rules and learn to comply with the chain of command, because we had a chain of command. So I went through all that, and there it was. After 7 years, I took final vows. I was in the convent for 20. I was in the convent for 20 years, but the ending all happened when I was sent to Puerto Rico. I'll tell you that story when we come back. We'll be back in about 2 minutes. Please don't go away. You know, it's kind of therapeutic. It's fun to share with you. And I'm going to thank you for listening. And Robert, I am loving you and missing you and praying that you're okay. Stay with us.
French Rastafarian baker Chef Hugues Mott is a fourth-generation baker and has worked in 11 countries across 3 continents. Born in Mulhouse, France, he began apprenticing in his father's bakery at age 12 and has devoted his life to learning cultures of the world from inside kitchens across the globe. He also teaches traditional French baking by hosting demonstrations and classes, and his passion for baking is reflected in his delicious confections. With a deep respect for discipline and his Rastafarian way of life, Sheikh Ugmat exemplifies commitment to tradition and culture in a global world. Traveling extensively and combining a myriad of flavors into his recipes, Chef Ugmat brings a unique approach to baking. To read more about the French Rastafarian baker, visit www.frenchchefugues.com. That's H-U-G-U-E-S. Bon appetit and bless up. Renaissance woman, trailblazer, maverick. Those are just some of the words to describe Tashandra Poulard, owner and CEO of House Virgo Entertainment, LLC, a woman minority veteran-owned entertainment company based in Washington, D.C. Ms. Poulard served 10 years honorably in the United States Navy and departed from active duty to pursue her dreams of becoming an entertainment mogul. House of Virgo Entertainment offers script writing, producing, directing, DJ services, editing, and more. They cater to businesses, corporations, college students, working professionals, aspiring artists and nonprofit organizations, and employ veterans of the armed forces. Tashandra Poulard is pioneering the way we view media and taking her brand global. Visit her at www.houseofvirgoentertainment.com or call 281-515-3740 and like her on Facebook at House of Virgo Entertainment, LLC.
Welcome back, everyone. So glad you haven't left. I hope I'm not boring you, but I'm just sharing some of my life journey. Like I say, I'm a writer. I've written 8 books, and 2 of them are about convent life. So not to leave you in suspense, but I'll let you know. What happened was I was sent to Puerto Rico, and I asked the Mother General, please, I'll go anywhere. You can send me anywhere. At the time, I was teaching in Tampa, Florida. I said, please, you know, I failed Spanish in high school. I got an A in college, but I'm not fluent. I'm not really great at that language. You know, you're sending me to a country where everybody speaks Spanish. Now, this was back in the, back in the early 80s, and it was like that. So anyway, a vow of obedience. Within 3 weeks, I was packed and shipped off, and I was in Puerto Rico. I had a superior, and I had a principal. And they were very good friends. They got along real well. And I was truly the odd man out. But I did the best I could. The kids didn't listen to me. I've never had disrespectful children before this. They were laughing. They were talking. And I didn't know that down in Puerto Rico back in the day, there were lots of Puerto Ricans who were very upset that, you know, we acquired them. Spanish American, I don't know how much history you know, but the Spanish American War in 1898, there was the Maine, USS Maine, an American ship blown up in the harbor of Cuba. And the American people basically blamed Spain because Cuba belonged to Spain at the time. And so we declared war. We Americans declared war on Spain. Well, that only lasted a few months because they didn't want to fight with us. They had just come out of a civil war. So what happened was we said, okay, fine. We'll make peace. We'll make a treaty, but we want Puerto Rico. We want Guam and we want the Philippines. And then you can sign the treaty and all's well that ends well. And the first thing America told Puerto Rico was, you will study English. And they basically said, you're nuts. We're not studying English. You're not going to tell us. Our grandma and grandpa lives over in Spain. You imperialists up there, you Anglos up there in the United States, there's no way we're going to speak your language. So it was very controversial. And by the time I got there, you know, I think it was 1982 or something like that. It was very controversial. Some of my parents wanted the kids to learn English. Some of my parents didn't want them to learn English. So when I did an assignment, some of the kids did it and some of them didn't. I mean, some parents wanted them to learn English so that they could go to the United States and have a far, far better life in this country. And you know, my 3 months in Puerto Rico, I got my eyes opened. I'm only telling you what I experienced, okay? I remember people speeding on the highway, and a policeman would stop them. And if you gave them $10, they'd go away. I was floored when I saw this happening. Some of the different people were telling me stories. I thought, that doesn't happen in the United States. I also saw, a car accident. This lady, the traffic, they broke all the rules. They drive on the wrong side of the road. If they didn't want to wait, they just go on the curb. They just broke rules all the time. And I know this one lady, I don't know if she saw me or not, but she drove right into the side of my car, and I was pretty upset. But, hey, it only took the next day to get the car pounded out and all fixed and up and running again, because they have accidents there all the time. So Puerto Rico was different for me, and I got very depressed. And I really, I wanted to go at Christmas, because at that time, all of us had the right to have a Christmas vacation. And when I approached my superior, she said, oh, no, you have to get permission from the Mother General in Syracuse. And I said, what? Everybody gets a Christmas break. I need to see my family, my friends, my culture, my food. I what do you mean? Hilaire, you have to get permission. So that's, I wrote a letter and I told God, if she says yes, I'm going to stay and I'm going to endure. Because I never found convent life easy. I don't think it was easy for others to live with me either. But anyway, the truth of the matter is that I told God, if I can't go home for a break, then that's a sign that I need to leave. And if I can go home, then that's a sign I am to stay and continue this journey, as hard and as horrific as it was. I mean, Puerto Rico wasn't the only place I had hard times. I mean, I actually, when I lived in Albany, New York, I wanted to commit suicide. I was so depressed. I went to the doctor. I'd lost 30 pounds. I thought I had cancer. And he said, no, this is not a healthy environment for you. And I remember sleeping on the floor and taking cold showers and doing penance. And one day I was on the roof, three stories up, and I honestly wanted to end it all. And I was in so much pain. And then I was standing right there, ready to go. And I heard a little voice say to me, but your mother will not know why. Oh, my gosh. I thought about my mother. I wasn't thinking about her. I was only thinking about me and how much pain I was in. But when I thought about my mother, I thought, oh, my glory, I will put her in hell the rest of her life. So I backed away. And then eventually I went to the Mother General and I pleaded my cause. And it's a long story. But anyway, the bottom line is she changed me. And that helped a lot. But I had a lot of hard times in the convent. So Puerto Rico was just one of many. It wasn't the only one. And as it turned out, she wrote me a letter and said, dear sister, I really think you should stay for Christmas. It's there a lot of nice holiday things going on down there, a lot of decorations. You can bond with the two sisters. So no, you're not going to have a Christmas break. And I had taken this paper, this letter, into the chapel with me. And I kissed it. And I said, God, your holy will, whatever it is. And when I opened it up, I started to cry because I knew that was the deal breaker. I was going to leave. So I stepped out of the chapel and there they were waiting to see what the answer was, because I had told them what was going on. And I said, you know, I'm going upstairs. I'm calling the Mother General. You can listen in if you'd like to. I don't care. Use the phone downstairs. So I went upstairs and I called and she just said, sister, it's just better for you to stay in Puerto Rico. And I said, no, it isn't, sister. I said, how do I leave? And actually, Robert is calling me right now. Robert, is that you? No, before 7, 7 o'clock. We're always at 7. So can you call in that number, okay, that I gave you? Well, God bless you. Thank you so much. To the rescue. All right, you guys, live action. He thought it was at 8 and not 7. And that's on me that I didn't clarify that with him. I don't know what happened. But stay with us. When you come back, you're going to meet my friend Robert Moore. I love this man. Thank you.
Animal lover, author, artist, and public speaker, Patricia Dalyliepe is a Renaissance woman in her own right. A lover of animals from a young age, Patricia lives on a farm in Virginia and has rescued neglected thoroughbred horses, keeping them or finding them safe havens. She is also a published author, and her books document real-life experiences that she shares in her passionate stories, taking the reader around the world in a colorful kaleidoscope of life. An accomplished artist, Patricia Dalyliepe's oil paintings feature animals, portraits, stills, nature, and abstract, and she allows the brush to paint the image in an organic, natural way. A public speaker, Patricia is motivated to continually wonder about life and advocates for all of us to do the same and document our own unique history. To learn more about Patricia Daily Life, visit www.literarylady.com and www.patricialife.com or email her at pdlife@gmail.com.
Introducing betterhomeandgarden.com. That's www.betterhomeandgarden.com with just the letter N in Better Home and Garden. BetterHomeAndGarden.com offers you the highest quality products on the market that are environmentally safe and effective, and to make them available to you at the lowest possible prices. BetterHomeAndGarden.com understands that kind of creativity and do-it-yourself attitude. Thus, we developed our website, BetterHomeAndGarden.com. BetterHomeAndGarden.com offers you the following products right online: bath, bedding, collectibles, craft, sewing and hobby, food and beverage, furniture, home decor, kitchen and dining, lamps and lighting, large appliances, musical instruments, outdoor cooking, patio items, pet supplies, plant and garden, rug and floor covering, small appliances, travel and luggage, and so much more. Better Home and Garden is an online retailer offering a wide variety of high-quality brand-name merchandise at discount prices. Our service is personal and we aim to please. Visit us at www.betterhomeandgarden.com. Make your home your own.
Welcome back, everyone. So glad you're still with us. The best news ever. My friend Robert Moore is here, and he's going to talk about technology and life. At least we'll get some of the concepts in. I've asked this man to present at the Northeast Ohio Christian Writers Conference because he has been in this field for over 20 years. Not only has he studied it, he has taught it. So, Robert, I understand that you are with us. You're there, right?
I am here and happy and thankful to be here with you all.
Oh, I'm thrilled to have you. And I've got some questions for you. So I'm giving you the floor, my friend. First of all, is there anything you want us to know about you before I start pounding you with questions?
Well, one of the things, since we're talking about technology, is I've been working in technology for well over 20 years, and I've been a fan of it for my whole life, and it's changed my life for the better. And hopefully some of the listeners will pick up some things that'll help them as well.
Right. Now, could you tell me what new things in technology do you think are helping people? What's going on today?
Well, the biggest thing that I'm excited about and that I'll be presenting at our conference is virtual reality. Virtual reality seems like this thing that people slip away and have fun in, and it's a waste of time, but actually it's not. There's a lot of applications with virtual reality that are helping people with Alzheimer's and other issues, depression, anxiety, education, and pretty much what it is you're slipping on either glasses, goggles, or something of that nature, and because of the view and the sound, it's putting you in a whole nother world. So you could play games, but you might find yourself walking through the forest. You might find yourself sitting on a beach, enjoying a movie. You might find yourself working in a virtual office or going to a virtual conference. Nursing homes are starting to use it for people with dementia, where they can watch videos and things of their past relatives that they might not have an opportunity to do. So virtual reality is definitely hot. Another thing is something called 5G. What that is, it's pretty much your cell phone connection, or the connection that you're using for your cell phone. It's going to become so fast that your telephone provider will be able to compete with the broadband connector that you're using in your city.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. Wow. Well, what technologies do you think that we should be worried about or concerned about? Is there any, you know, downsides going on here? That sounds very uplifting, and I never thought about all that. But what technologies should people be concerned with?
Well, with technology getting into the hands of anyone these days, there are some people that will use it for bad. And one of the things that people are looking for the most is your data. A lot of services and things that you use for free, they're actually making money by selling off your data. Now, for a lot of people, that may not be such a big deal. But you want to know who they're selling the data to and who's actually collecting the data. There are some companies like Facebook and some others that are selling and collecting your data. And for the most part, what's on there, it doesn't really bother me so much. But there are companies that are based out of countries that I don't want to have my data or what I'm saying. So if I'm politically active and maybe I'm against a certain regime in a certain country, if there is a piece of technology coming from that company or from that country that they're collecting my data, I'm probably not going to buy that device. And you'll see certain countries not buying government devices from these companies, from these countries, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, and the reason they're not buying from data from these countries is because they're not dependable, or what's going on? What do you mean?
Well, I'll be more specific. There are certain tech companies from China that are doing business in other countries, and you can buy those products for much more cheaper. But they are collecting your data. So there's one company called Huawei. They are selling phones and things, and those things are going to collect your data. They also have software that's going to collect your data. That data is not being used for selling you a microwave or selling you a certain product. It's going back to the Chinese government. Now, if I have different views on the Chinese government that I'm posting online with my Huawei phone, they may see me as a problem. And if I happen to visit China, I could find myself in trouble. It seems kind of big brotherish, but it's something to be mindful of. Another example would be the old IBM company was purchased by Lenovo. Lenovo is now owned by a Chinese company that is controlled by China, and their laptops are a lot cheaper. But when people were first buying them, when the first changeover happened, it was found out that they were pre-installed with malware, and that's something that collects your data and sends it back to them. So those are certain things just to be mindful of, is the products that you're buying, the brands, the companies, where they're from, and knowing that they will be collecting your data.
Well, that's kind of a form of spying on us, don't you think?
Yes, it is. In fact, so much that some companies are saying they're not going to buy any equipment from Huawei or any other companies like that.
I know for a long time I've heard about China stealing things that are on the internet and ideas and taking things. And then, like, we have copyright laws here. We have certain for writers and all this sort of thing, but they don't respect those laws. So they'll take something good and print it there and maybe put their name on it. You know, now that we're connected with so many other countries in the moment, you know, with all this technology, some terrible things are going on. Can I ask you this question? Can technology be used to save money? I mean, is it something we can use? Is it useful for us?
Oh, absolutely. Going back to VR, I'm somebody who I dream of having an 80-inch television in my living room or over 100-inch television. Well, with virtual reality, I can go to my own virtual multi-million-dollar penthouse and I can watch Netflix, Hulu, and even my regular cable subscription on a 100-inch TV in my swaggy living room for the cost of what I paid for my virtual reality set. If I went to the store and I bought a television that large, it might set me back a couple grand. Or I can throw on my $200 virtual reality set and sit and enjoy it in the privacy of my multi-million dollar pad. Another thing is trips. Being an author as well, there are certain scenes that I'll write that involve going to a place such as India or Australia, but I've never been to those places, and I would have to book airfare, a hotel, probably find a tour guide to help me get around. That costs thousands and thousands of dollars. Or once again, I can throw on my $200 VR set, and I can go to India, and I can see the sights. I might not be able to smell the smells, but I can hear the sounds and explore things that way. So it saves thousands of dollars.
You're absolutely blowing my mind, sir. That is, you wonder about the future. You know, you mentioned that you wrote books, and would you just even mention that you're an author, a very accomplished author? What did you write?
I wrote two books. One is called Till Death Do Us Part. It's about a woman who perishes in a plane crash with her husband. When she gets to heaven, she goes looking for him, only to find out her first husband's been waiting on her the entire time. So who does she spend eternity with? Is it husband number one, who's Prince Charming, or husband number two, who is Mr. Excitement and Mr. Adventure? And that ties into technology as well, because at the time, I finished the manuscript and I had some very serious health issues, to where I was practically bedridden. Now, one of the things that you have to do as an author when you get a book out is you got to let people know, you got to market it. And I could not leave the house and go shake hands and kiss babies. But what I was able to do was get on the internet, let people know it was available, do virtual shops and virtual talks. And the book did very well based on technology. And then the second book was, it's called Listen to My Kaleidoscope. It's about the people who were there for me in times of need, and just heartwarming stories about appreciating people, appreciating life, and appreciating the things that we were blessed with.
You know, Robert, I read that book, and you know I loved it. I would highly recommend it, especially some of those characters are actually from Lorraine and different true stories. I found it so inspiring. I want to know more, and we're going to give you the floor. I'm going to be quiet and just listen to you, but we're going to just take a little break right now, Robert, and we'll be back in two. So you guys, don't go away. Robert's got more to share. God bless. Thank you.
If you seek a courageous advocate prepared to champion your rights with consumer service agencies that support aging populations, Carol Ann Hamilton is the one for you. Carol Ann is an elder care coach, author, and speaker with a 250,000 hours lived experience successfully supporting uncopable aging parents. As a result of a challenging journey, Carol Ann revolutionizes how stressed out caregivers restore serenity to their worlds. She also brings over 25 years of change management expertise in Fortune 500 settings to catalyze urgent transformation within the elder care industry. Carol Ann is a popular speaker at conferences across North America. She has appeared via TV, radio, and print globally. Now you can tune in weekly to get a dose of her inspiration, plus down-to-earth advice to cope with even the most difficult aging parents. Listen Wednesdays at 9 a.m. Eastern on Bold Brave Media and TuneIn Radio.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner, and you're listening to Dr. T, PhD. We're coming to you live on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. And as you know, Mr. Robert Moore, one of my favorite humanoids, one of the best people I've ever known in my life. You know I love you, Robert. There's just no getting around it.
I
got to tell you this. Oh, thank you so much. When you sent me the picture of your daughter, who's 1 year old, you know, that very day, I mean, as soon as I opened it up and I looked at that gorgeous face, I put it in the most famous, special place of the house on the refrigerator door. So I just wanted to share that with you. And your letter meant so much to me.
God bless you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I wanted to ask you, how do we get your books if we wanted to order them? What's the story? What do we do?
Well, they're available on all platforms. So if you're an e-reader, you can get them from the iBookstore, Amazon, your regular avenues for that. You can also go to two certain websites. My website, www.morewriting.com. That's with two O's. You can get there. You can find my books there. You can find the International Writers Association podcast on that website, along with lists of guests and their books as well. So if you're looking for a one-shop stop Home Depot where you can find various authors that you'd want to read and even listen to, you can go to morewriting.com. Another website you can go to is the internationalwritersassociation.com. where not only are my books listed, but the books of other super talented authors from around the world there as well. We all help each other in our endeavors, and we use technology to advance people's writing and writing aspirations. So internationalwritersassociation.com and morewriting.com.
And I highly recommend it. Now, listen, guys, I've had a PhD. I have read more books than you can shake a stick at. And I'm telling you, his books are really inspiring, enlightening, and really make you think. Now, Robert, I want to ask you this question. What got you so taken to technology? Why are you so interested in it?
Well, growing up, technology really wasn't a part of my life. And I definitely did have a challenging childhood growing up, and it was just about daily survival. We weren't thinking about the internet or the web or anything like that. Well, I got put in a technology class, and I was just taking it just to get a grade. And I'm a competitive person. And my junior year, We went to a state final in a competition, and we lost, and we should have thought we should have won. And I told my teammates, we're all going to sign up for this class again, and we're gonna go for it. And we didn't get it that second time, but the senior year, I found out that the lifestyle of technology and how it can advance your life, and it also could take me out of my situation, and that really got me involved in technology. It's a change of life.
Wow. What's your favorite tech?
My favorite tech right now is virtual reality. I absolutely love it. Recently, I started having anxiety attacks, and just going into virtual reality and spending time there has absolutely helped. And as far as learning new things, a good example, Easter's coming up. They have a visual of the crucifixion or the crucifixion. And you can actually be there and see the sounds and the different ways people reacted. That's an experience that it's just unbelievable.
You're unbelievable. I don't know what to say. I just think the world of you. You've taught me so much. I'm 70 years old. You're a young man, but you have mentored me as easily as much as I've helped you. Trust me. I'm so grateful. I'm not sure exactly how many more minutes we have. So I'll tell you what, in 30 seconds, we're going to be needing to take a break. So why don't we... Last segment. This is our break. So I'm just going to ask God to watch over you, my friend, keep you safe, your blessed, beautiful family, all those who love you. I thank you for being with me and being in my life. And thank you, listeners, for staying with us tonight. And God bless boldbravemedia.com and all the writers in the world. Amen. Thank you.
I can feel your presence, I can feel your loving power in the gift of this communion, in this holy hour. Jesus, will you heal me of my iniquity? This I ask of you, 'cause I believe in you.
Tune in next week for more thought-provoking conversation with Dr. Hilaire Taverner on Dr. T, PhD.
And I can feel the Holy Spirit now, 'cause I believe.
You've been listening to the BBM Global Network. The ideas, views, and opinions of this broadcast are those of the participants of the program and are not necessarily the ideas, views, and opinions of the BBM Global Network Company.